Redo.
Talk Jesus tonight. We're going to lift up his name because his name is to be glorified and a wonderful thing. We want to welcome you all to the Door Christian Fellowship this evening. And this is our live stream attempt. We're trying to get it all right. We're going to do that tonight. So we want to sing a few songs. The only problem is I don't have my song list in front of me. So the first one we're going to sing is Edwin's going to put up there on the screen so I can begin to do that.
It's a new and living way of walking. It's a new and living way God has planned.
Wonderful Holy Ghost,
from heaven.
Holy Ghost, you wonderful Holy Ghost, like wind blowing down,
blowing from heaven.
We have decided to go all the way for our God,
revive the land that's our goal.
As soldiers in his army, we'll fight with heart and soul.
Calling down blood and fire, like a strong blowing wind, blowing from heaven.
His blood, his fire, we're calling down blood and fire, like a strong blowing wind,
blowing from heaven.
We have decided to
go
all the way for our God, reviving the land that's our goal. Like soldiers in his army, we'll fight with heart and soul.
Blood and fire, we're calling down fire
and fire, like strong blowing wind.
Blood is fire. We're calling down blood and fire, like a strong moving wind, blowing from heaven.
Oh,
Father God, we thank you, Lord God. We praise you, Lord God. We give you all the glory in Jesus' name. Oh, Father God, we thank you, Lord God. We praise you, Lord God, in Jesus' name.
Holy Ghost, you
wonderful Holy Ghost,
like a wind blowing down,
blowing from heaven.
Holy Ghost,
his wonderful Holy Ghost,
like wind blowing down,
blowing from heaven.
We have
decided to go all the way for our God,
revival
in the land, that's our goal.
Like soldiers in his army,
we'll fight with heart and soul.
Blood
and fire,
we're
calling down blood and fire,
like strong
blowing wind, blowing from heaven.
His blood
is fire,
we're calling down blood and fire,
like strong blowing wind, blowing from heaven.
There's one answer, and that's Jesus. I don't know all the problems everyone's facing, but there is one answer, and that is Jesus.
Jesus is the answer for the world today. Above him there's no other. Jesus is the way. Jesus is the answer for the world today. Above him there's no other. Jesus is the way. You might have some questions in the corners of your mind, fringes of discouragement and peace you cannot find, reflections of your past seem to bring to you every day. But this one thing I do know, Jesus is the way. Jesus is the answer for the world today. Above him there's no other. Jesus is the way. Jesus is the answer for the world today. Above him there's no other. Jesus is the way. If you have some questions in the corner of your mind, traces of discouragement and peace you cannot find, reflections of your mind seem to visit you every day, this one thing I do know, Jesus is the way. Jesus is the answer for the world today. Above him there's no other. Jesus is the way. Jesus is the answer for the world today. Above him there's no other. Jesus is the way. Oh, Father God, we thank you, Lord God. We praise you, Lord God. We give you all the glory in Jesus' name. Hallelujah.
We want to pray for all the nations of the earth that are trying to make sense of this crazy coronavirus and this COVID-19, all the things that are going on in the nations. And we want to pray for our own president, that God would keep him and keep him strong and give him wisdom. We want to pray for all the leaders of the nations that are making these tough decisions. We want to pray for in every crisis that every leader would come to Jesus Christ. That when all of us are in a crisis, we would go to Christ. To go to the Savior, to go to Jesus. We want to pray for all the churches that are trying their best to win the war against not only this virus, but a far more deadly virus, that sin that comes against us. And faithful men in God in each church, pastors, their families, the congregations are fighting for that war. We want to pray for your family that are watching there with us this evening. And we want to pray that you won't just watch, that you will partake and do any, lift your hands, shout amen on Facebook. I don't know how you do those things, but anything you want to take part in that, because you are the church. You are the church. And take part in the giving as we take our tithes and offerings and the blessing that comes as you do that. I've been so encouraged by all of that. And we can face a world that is looking at just a hopeless end with an endless hope in Jesus. There's a few other things that we want to pray for this evening. We want to pray for Brian Zapata's aunt, Yolanda Novero. She's a pediatrician. She's a first-line responder. She has coronavirus. She's battling in the hospital. She has received the Lord Jesus. Thank God for that. And Brian has prayed with her. But she really does need a miracle healing power. She needs to feel his presence. She feels alone. She can talk with no one. So we want to pray for her. And also that God would strengthen her lungs and God would be with her there in that room. We also want to pray for all the prayer requests that are being posted on the Tucson website. I encourage you to go there. They're fasting and praying. And for the next 40 days, and you can put your prayer request up there. Churches all around the world will be able to see those requests, and they will do that. I've already been doing that. I started fasting today. And so I want to encourage you to do the same thing. And put your prayer request up there. They'll post them up there. They'll go all over the world doing that. During this 40 days of prayer and fasting, especially those that have been battling with coronavirus. There are several in the Tucson church. I was praying for Kristen Cootie, Georgia. I was also praying for Shakiko Arbo, and she passed away before this day. So we want to pray right now for Paul Arbo, for his son Paul Arbo. Paul Arbo Sr. lost his wife, and Paul Arbo, not lost them. We know where they are. They're in heaven. And thank God for that. Thank God for the prayers of the saints. There are people in every congregation that you're going to have to be faced with this, and that we need to fast and pray now. Because Jesus one time said that this kind only comes out by prayer and fasting. So there are things that we can do, and let's do it. Let's be about the Father's business. So we want to pray for all of that today, that God will really comfort the Arbo family that has seen that matriarch go home to heaven and her reward there. We want to just lift our hands and just right there where you are, stand up, lift your hands to God. Say, God, you help me and you help all the people of the world, and just know that you have it all in control. And then when we finish up, we're just going to have Simon come up close us off in prayer. Father, right now,
Father God, we thank you, Lord God, we praise you, Lord God, we give you all the glory, Lord God, and all the praise.
Father God, we thank you, Lord God, for your grace, for your mercy, for the precious gift of salvation. Lord, for the blood of Jesus Christ that was poured out for our sins, we pray tonight in this place. And Lord, an outpouring of your Holy Spirit that you administer to every heart. Lord, we pray, Lord God, for everyone that is listening in, Lord God. Lord, that you would touch these souls, Lord God. Lord, that your word would go forth. Release the conviction of your Holy Spirit. Lord, bring us to a place of decision, Lord God. Lord, we pray that you will pour out your spirit across the land, Lord God. We pray for healing virtue for those that are sick in body. We pray for those that are hospital beds. Lord, I pray, Lord God, that they would know that they're not isolated from you, Lord God. Lord, that you would visit them in their time of sickness. Lord, that you would bring healing. Lord, we pray, Lord, for our fellowship, that you would continue to move powerfully throughout the nations, Lord God. And Father God, we thank you, we praise you, we give you all the glory and all the praise. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Praise God. We want to welcome you out to the Dual Christian Fellowship this evening, and we're glad that you're joining with us. And we hope to bring you the good news that Jesus Christ has risen from the dead. What happened after Easter? That's what I want to talk about tonight. But before we do that, I just want to take an offering this evening, and just want to encourage you. I really have been so very much encouraged by all the saints of God that continue to tithe and offering. And so is every pastor in every church. They are so much need to see the church be the church. The church will continue to give, and faithful people are full of faith. And one of the best ways you can be full of faith is by showing that appreciation to God and honoring Jesus in your tithes and in your offerings and supporting your local church and your local pastor. There are several ways that you can do that. You can go on our website, thedoorsb.com or sbay4j.com. When you get on that website, there'll be an online giving button. You can click on that. It takes only a few seconds actually, just to do that. You can put in your information, and you can go ahead and send that off to us here. And you take care of your own local church as well. Please be supporting that. I'm so thankful for the people of God here that are doing just that. Praise God. I want to speak to you for a few minutes about what happened after Easter. And maybe, Sandra, if you could just zoom in on my little friends here. Can you get those real good? What happened after Easter? Because the Easter story kind of got messed up. When you're looking at my little friends here that say it's Easter egg, and then an Easter bunny, and then three little Easter eggs that are following that little Easter bunny. And it kind of got messed up in a weird race of chocolate rabbits that lay eggs. I mean, you can't really get much further away from Easter than that, as far as I'm concerned. Now, take it easy. Don't get mad at me because I got chocolate. I'm going to eat these bad boys later on after I've finished my fast. Okay? But I'm just trying to say so. I'm pointing something out. Because what happened after Easter has morphed into many deadly religious fantasies that have nothing to do with Christianity. I love chocolate. I'm going to have it tomorrow, and it's due time. But I want to point something out to them. And these fantasies that masquerade as Christianity, what happened on Easter was the single most important event in the history of the world. Jesus rose from the dead. But what happened after Easter is equally important. What's going to happen after your Easter? What's going to happen once the corona or COVID-19 is all finished? But what happened that after Easter is also one of the single most important events in history. It was the birth of the church. The birth of the church. The growth of the church. The mission of the church and the power of these Christian disciples and followers of Jesus and the church and its call to reach the world until Jesus returns. That's pretty radical. The events that have happened in life aside of that are minor in comparison. We understand the Father, but how many understand that view of God has gotten very bent? We also understand the Son, Jesus, but that view of God has also gotten very bent. And we need to live by His Holy Spirit, and even that view of God has gotten very bent. But if you read the book of Acts, if you read the fifth gospel, if you read what happened after Easter, you see the importance of the church. You see its birth, you see its growth, you see all the things that come against it. The book of Acts is what happened after Easter. What's going to happen after Easter for you? What's going to happen after COVID-19? We're going to have to hear from Jesus. We're going to have to honor Jesus. Because hearing from Jesus and honoring Jesus, you see heaven rather than hell. So I want to read to you a portion of scripture out of the book of Acts in chapter 1. This is what happens after Easter. Acts in chapter 1. I want to start with verse 1. The former account I made, O Theophilus, of all that Jesus began to both do and teach, until the day in which he was taken up, after he, through the Holy Spirit, had given commandments to the apostles whom he had chosen, to whom he also presented himself alive after his suffering by many infallible proofs, being seen by them during the 40 days and speaking of the things pertaining to the kingdom of God. And being assembled together with them, he commanded them not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise of the Father, which he said, you have heard from me. For John truly baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Spirit not many days from now. Therefore, when they had come together, they asked him, saying, Lord, will you restore at this time the kingdom of Israel? And Jesus said to them, it's not for you to know the times or the seasons which the Father has put in his own authority, but you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you. And you shall be witnesses to me in Jerusalem, in all Judea and Samaria, in Gardena, in Tucson, in Prescott, in Papua New Guinea, all over the world. God will move in your life. Now, when he spoke these things, as they watched, Jesus was taken up into a cloud and received into heaven out of his sight. And while they looked steadfastly towards that heaven, as Jesus went up, behold, two men stood by him, by them, in white apparel, and he said, men of Gardena, why do you stand gazing up into heaven? This same Jesus, who was taken up into heaven, he will so come in like manner as you saw him go into heaven. Father, in the name of your Son, Jesus, help us to see the way.
way you went the first time in the power of your Holy Spirit. God, help us to be open to that this evening, our lives directed by the power of that Holy Spirit. That what happens after this Easter, God, will be like no other Easter ever before, because this Easter has been like no other Easter. God, I'm asking you that in the strong name of your Son, Jesus. Amen. So first thing I want you to think about with me is hearing it from Jesus. Listening to Jesus. Not just hearing. I hear noise, but I don't want to listen to it. I want to listen to that. Jesus. You know, the Gospels don't go very far after the Easter service. When you look at the four Gospels and Easter and Jesus' death and resurrection, Matthew only goes five verses past that. Mark only goes 7 verses past that. Luke goes 11 verses. John takes at least 2 chapters and tells what happened after Easter. But Luke, he has writing the whole second letter to tell us what happened after Easter. He wrote the Gospel of Luke, but then he also wrote the book of Acts, the 5th Gospel, to tell his good friend, his influential friend, Theophilus, just exactly what happened. Luke chapter 1 and verse 1, the first time he wrote to him, says, "Inasmuch as many have taken in hand to set in order a narrative of those things which have been fulfilled among us, just as those who from the beginning were eyewitnesses and the minister of the word delivered them to us, it seemed good to me also, having had a perfect or a complete understanding of all the things from the very first, to write to you an orderly account, O excellent, most excellent Theophilus, that you may know the certainty of those things in which you were instructed." He wrote a whole gospel about that. In the book of Acts, that we just read in our scripture, Acts chapter 1, it says, "The former account I made," he's talking about that gospel, "the former account I made, O Theophilus, of all that Jesus began to do and teach until the day in which he was taken up, after he, through the Holy Spirit, had given commandments to the apostles whom he had chosen, to whom he also presented himself alive after his suffering, by many infallible," say infallible, infallible, "by many infallible proofs, being seen by them 40 days, speaking of the things pertaining to the kingdom of God." Oh, my goodness. The book of Acts, the 5th Gospels, the book of the people, the gospel of the people. He wanted his friend to know. Don't you want your friends to know? I do. We have influence on our friends. And I want them to know the truth. And the best way for your friends to know the truth is for you and I to be the truth. That we would live this after Easter the way we should live it. After Easter, Jesus was reappearing over 40 days. He was popping up everywhere to bring further instruction to the disciples, presenting infallible proofs, truths that cannot be changed. Real friends, don't let real friends go to hell. They do everything they can possibly do. Real friends, don't let friends go to hell. John the Baptist had told them about the Holy Ghost. Jesus had told them about the Holy Ghost, but he comes now again, and he does it over 40 days about the Holy Ghost. But if you want to know something about the Holy Ghost has been around for a long time. In fact, the Holy Ghost has been around since the beginning of the earth. In Genesis and chapter 1, verse 1 says, "In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. And the earth was without form and void, and darkness was on the face of the deep. And the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of the waters. Then God said," oh, when God says something, He said, let us make man in our image, according to our likeness. Let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, and over the birds of the air, and over the cattle, and over all of the earth, and over every creeping thing that creeps on the earth. How many of you know there's a lot of creepy things on the earth? He said the earth was without form and void. I put my name there. Bruce was without form, and he was void. And Bruce was filled with darkness. But the Spirit of God was hovering over the face of Bruce. And then God said, only two verses into the Old Testament, two verses. He said, let us. Who's us? Who's he talking about? He's talking about the Father. He's talking about the Son. He's talking about the Spirit of God, the Holy Ghost. Let us make man in our image, in our likeness, that they might have dominion. That's the only time you have dominion. When you let the Holy Ghost have you, you've got dominion. That's the only way we'll ever have dominion over our selfish selves is the Holy Ghost. Mark chapter 1, verse 7. Mark chapter 1, verse 7. And he preached, saying, there comes one after me who is mightier than I. This is Jesus preaching. Then he this is John the Baptist. He comes in who preaches mightier than I, whose sandal strap I am not worthy to stoop down and loose. Indeed, I baptize you with water, but he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit. That's what's happening after Easter. Luke chapter 3 is repeated for us. In verse 16, Jesus answered and said, John answered, saying to all, I indeed baptize you with water, but there is one mightier than I who's coming, whose sandal strap I'm not worthy to loose, and he will baptize you with the Holy Spirit and fire. Can we hear it from Jesus tonight? Can we hear from Jesus tonight the importance of the Holy Spirit? Hear what? Our need for the Holy Spirit. The promise of the Holy Ghost. In the New King James, which is the Bible version I prefer, it calls it the Holy Spirit. I actually like to call him the Holy Ghost. I like it because it kind of freaks people out when you say ghost. Even spirits kind of freak them out. But I kind of like the Holy Ghost, and I translated that many times, even when I'm preaching. So I grew up in a religion that was kind of strange. They had a red lantern type thing on the altar there, and it had to keep burning, and they said, that's the Holy Ghost. I go, ooh, that's the Holy Ghost. I remember one time some guy, one of us was really thirsty, they took some drink of some holy water, and they got a toothache. Man, I don't know how to do that again. I love the Holy Ghost. I know the Holy Ghost loves me. Amen. Acts chapter 1 and verse 4 of our scripture says, and being assembled together with them, Jesus commanded them not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise of the Father, which he said, you've heard from me. Can we hear it from Jesus tonight? You've heard from me. For John truly baptized with water, but you shall be baptized with the Holy Spirit, and not many days from now. The promise of the Holy Ghost. He said, don't do anything until you've got the Holy Ghost. And we do everything without the Holy Ghost. Some don't even know the Holy Ghost exists. They have no idea. That's why I'm preaching this tonight. Because that's what happened after Easter. The Holy Ghost came. And, you know, it was a good idea for us to pray. Before we do anything, to pray in the Holy Ghost. Because that's the only time we have dominion. That helps us when we do that. Over the next 40 days, Jesus is going to continually appear at different times, at different places, to different people, infallible proof that he's alive. And then he says, don't do anything until you get the Holy Ghost. What he's saying is, don't do anything until the Holy Ghost is gone. Praying before we do anything is always a good idea. 1 Corinthians chapter 15, we see him going all these different places at different times during these 40 days. 15 verse 4 says he was buried and then he rose again on the third day, according to the scriptures. And he was seen by Cephas, and then by the 12. And after that, he was seen by over 500 brethren at one time. Of whom the greater part remained to the present, but some have fallen asleep. You know, the Jew, when they wrote that, some had fallen asleep. They weren't talking about sleep. When people die, you know, sleep, they're not dead. See, they look like they're sleeping, but they're going to wake up somewhere that night. They're going to wake up either in heaven, or they're going to wake up either in hell. And that's the way that they thought about this thing. But after that, he was also seen by James, then by all the apostles. And last of all, he was seen by Bruce. He was seen by you. The last of all, he was seen by one born out of due time. This is what's happening after Christmas, after Easter. This is what's happening after Easter. Not some Hollywood ghost with Patrick Swayze promising Demi Moore, "I'm back here and I will love you forever and I will protect you forever." No, this is not a Hollywood, this is a Holy Ghost that will love you and protect you forever. This is the Holy Spirit. This is the resurrected Spirit of Jesus Christ. That promise that he brings to you and I. Don't do anything until you've got that promise. Once you've truly got the promise, then the promise truly gets a hold of you. Because without him, you can do nothing. Without him, I can do nothing. I'm not saying that. Jesus said it. And you know, whatever Jesus says, I have a tendency to believe. And it hasn't done me wrong in 40 years. John chapter 15, verse 5. He said, "I am the vine, and you are the branches. He who abides in me, and I in him, bears much fruit. For without me, you can do nothing." Jesus is speaking this at the Last Supper. He's speaking this at the last Passover. He's speaking this at the First Communion. Let's talk Jesus tonight. Let's talk Jesus. Let's hear from Jesus. He's the whole reason that he went through everything that he did on the cross. He went through 33 years on this earth, which would have been incredibly difficult for him, I'm sure. I've been barely making it myself. But I tell you, he went through all of that for one reason. That you and I would be able to receive the Holy Ghost. To give the Holy Ghost to you and I. You hear it from Jesus tonight, as you've heard from me. He spent nearly three chapters in John. If you read John 15, 14, 15, 16, you'll see Jesus there. And that's actually taking place during that last Passover, that last supper, that first communion. And he's talking to them and telling them. John chapter 14 and verse 16 says, "And I will pray the Father, and he will give you another helper, that he may abide with you forever. The Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive, because it neither sees him nor knows him, but you know him, and he dwells with you, and he will be in you. And I will not leave you as orphans. I will come to you." John chapter 14 again, verse 25 says, "These things I've spoken to you while being present with you, but the Helper, the Holy Spirit, whom the Father will send in my name, he will teach you all things, and he'll bring to your remembrance all things that I said to you. Peace I leave with you, my peace I give to you, not as the world gives, but I give to you. Let your heart not be troubled, neither let it be afraid." I believe what he says. Because what's happening after Christmas? I mean, after Easter? It's the Holy Ghost. What's going to happen after Easter for you? What's going to happen after COVID-19? You don't have to be scared or troubled. There are a lot of scared orphans out there, but I have trust in my Father. There's a lot of scared orphans. They didn't know about the Holy Ghost. When you read the book of Acts, you find them coming to people that didn't know about the Holy Spirit. You find people that were born again, that were saved, that didn't know about the Holy Spirit. They never heard it. Then you find people that have heard, and they neglect the Holy Spirit. Are you kidding me? They neglect that. This is the whole reason Jesus went through everything he did, so he could give us all. That's what's happening after Easter. We try to do all kinds of things without the Holy Ghost. We try to do things in our schools. We try to do things on the job. We take a job. We try to do all kinds of things. We try to get married. We try to have children. And we try to do church. There's no way. The Holy Ghost. So let's go secondly. If we can hear from Jesus, we'll honor him. We'll be honoring Jesus. The purpose of you receiving the Holy Ghost is simple. And it's stated simply by Jesus. To be baptized in the Holy Spirit. Baptism, the word baptism comes from a Greek word which means to be totally submerged. Totally submerged, completely under. It was used in the garment industry for dyeing garments and bringing them completely under. You don't want to be tie-dyed. You don't want to be in really different colors. Go all the way with Jesus. And so, he didn't baptize us in the Holy Spirit to just be a tongue talker. He baptized us with the Holy Spirit and the Holy Ghost that we would honor Jesus' call upon our life to give us the power to do and the power to be what he's called us to be. Acts chapter 1, our scripture, verse 4. He says, and being assembled together with them, he commanded them not to depart from Jerusalem, but to wait for the promise of the Father, which he said, you have heard from me. For John truly baptized with water, but you'll be baptized with the Holy Spirit, a Holy Ghost, not many days from now. Therefore, when they had come together, they asked him, saying, Lord, will you at this time restore the kingdom of Israel? And he said to them, it is not for you to know the time or the seasons which the Father has put in his own authority, but you shall receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you shall be witnesses to me, in Jerusalem, in Gardena, in all of Judea, in California, and Samaria, in the United States, and to the end of the earth. This is what's happening. This is what's happening after Easter. The power that you need to be a witness. The power that you need, and it's way beyond anything that we could ever conjure up ourselves. Power that is beyond our own power. To discern life, to size up the situations in life that are always coming at us. To make right decisions. To keep right decisions. To see through all the illusions and the lies of life. The purpose of the cross and the resurrection of Jesus Christ is for you and I to receive this Holy Spirit, to receive the Holy Ghost. To be, for what purpose is that? To be witnesses. The change in your life takes place because of the Holy Ghost. The change in your life is wonderful and powerful. That power and that change is going on all the time. That word witness is the Greek word martus, which where we get the English word martyr, someone that is willing to die for what they believe. The power that you and I need. Someone that's willing to die for the cause of Jesus Christ. It's where you honor him. Where do you do that? Everywhere. Where you live, where you work, where you go to school. Every city, every nation, every state, the nations of the earth. The power and the purpose of Jesus Christ is that you and I would be filled with the Holy Ghost. And that Holy Ghost would fill our lives completely in all the way. You know, one of the things I love to do when I go street preaching with a group of people is after we finish street preaching, is just grab hold of one's hand and just pray in the Holy Ghost. And you'd be amazed at some of the people that are watching while you're doing that. And I believe the power of God's there. That's one of the things I love to do. His Spirit at work in your life, exposing every lie of the flesh and revealing the deep truths of His Spirit. Jesus knows the world needs a simple and a clear demonstration of supernatural power. And yet,
foolishness to you, but it's not to me. I never know what I'm saying, but I know who's saying it. Because of what I read in the Bible, it's the Spirit that's praying on my behalf of my spirit. A simple demonstration for simple people. People try to make it so complex. Did you hear what the disciples said to him? He's risen from the dead. He's talking to him, and he's going, is this the time that you're going to come back? Or are we going to rule Israel? This is what these people were about. They didn't get it at first. They were scared orphans, scared people. Every one of them had denied Jesus. Yet he still works with them. I'm talking about an amazing God. Not only works with them, he gives them his spirit. These people had no idea what to expect. They knew it was going to be powerful. They understood it was going to be powerful. The resurrection was pretty powerful, so they were wondering, what's this going to be, this Holy Spirit? Jesus appeared to them over 40 days, and he's speaking to them. This is what happened after Easter. They never knew when he would walk through a wall. Jesus walked right through the wall. That'd be pretty crazy if I'd walk right through. He walked right through the wall, and he began to say those words to them. He walked right through the wall. This is what was happening after Easter. Jesus would meet two men walking on the road, and he would talk to them. This is what's happening after Easter. Jesus would meet a bunch of fishermen that had gone fishing, that had already forgotten about what he had told them. And he had breakfast with Jesus. That's what happens after Easter. And not only did he have breakfast with them, he had a Bible study with them too. And then he took Peter for a walk. This is what's happening. It's not a matter of shall I go to church. It's a matter of will I be the church. It's a matter of will I be the church. Overcoming my flesh. There's no greater example. You know, tomorrow morning I'm going to be pretty hungry when I wake up. I'm not going to want to get out of bed. It's going to be warm. It's going to be dark. It's going to be quiet. It's going to be comfortable. I'm going to get myself out of bed. I'm going to come down. I'm going to pray in the Holy Ghost. I'm going to pray in the Holy Ghost. So I know the power, and I know what's happening, and I know what's ahead. This is what happened after Christmas. You know, back in the hippie days, Lord said, hey, man, what's happening? What's happening? That has morphed into, what's up? What's up? What's up? I'll tell you what's up. Jesus. Let me finish with one final thought. When we hear it from Jesus and we honor him, then it's going to be heaven for us rather than hell. Because that's what Christmas and that's what Easter is all about. You can morph it into as many different things as you want to, but Christmas and Easter, the two most powerful holidays, I guess, if we're not wanting another word, they're about heaven and hell. They're about the first coming of Jesus. They're about his payment for our sin and his resurrection and the fact that he's going to come again. They're the real issues. Heaven and hell. Honoring him. Hearing from him. It's getting real. It's staying real. The promise that Jesus will come again. Supernaturally and physically. Our scripture reads in Acts chapter 1 and verse 9. Now when they had spoken these things, listen to these words. While they watched, he was taken up into a cloud and received him out of sight. While they looked steadfastly towards heaven, as Jesus went up, behold, two men stood by them in white apparel and said, Men of Galilee, why do you stand up gazing into heaven? This same Jesus who was taken up from you into heaven will so come in like manner as you saw him go into heaven. I saw him go into heaven in powerful glory. I saw him going into heaven saying, it is finished. He wasn't saying, I am finished. He was saying, it is finished. And he's not finished because he's ready. He's still going on. It's that Holy Ghost. And that's something to get radical. Listen, would it be strange if
If I stood here and I said, look at that, Sandro, Edward, you guys stay here until you hear from me again, you know, and all of a sudden you saw me just elevate and go through the roof, because that's what they were watching. While they were watching, Jesus was taken. They saw the rapture firsthand. They saw Jesus being lifted up into heaven, and he told them not to do anything until they got the Holy Ghost, the promise. It created such an expectation in their hearts. They went and had a 10-day prayer meeting about it. They waited 10 more days, and the lady of the Holy Ghost would come. And they said, as you see him go, I saw him go in magnificent power. And that's what happened to me when I got the Holy Ghost. The powerful force of expectation that would bring these people beyond any human tragedy, beyond any human triumph. They understood where the power came from. They understood where the opposition came from. They understood where the victory came from. No matter what the opposition was, it was the Holy Ghost that was at work in their life. And they overcame everything. They watched as Jesus was lifted up in the crowd. That's radical. That is radical. And how can anybody be anything but a radical Christian? I have no idea. That was the birth of the church. The church is the most powerful structure, organization, group of people in the face of the earth. Powerful. They were going to wait for the most powerful moment of their life. 10 days later, 50 days on the day of Pentecost, the Holy Ghost came upon them. They learned as they listened, as they obeyed, as they heard from Jesus, as they honored Jesus, and they found out heaven's a whole lot better than hell. They were friends, real friends. They were friends to the end. They were friends to the end to those who even betrayed them, to those that would berate them, to those that would try anything, but nothing would deter this people. The Holy Ghost was powering them. I'll finish up another sermon. It was beyond natural family ties. It was beyond that, it was supernatural family ties. The Holy Ghost guiding and directing their lives. Beyond every doubt, beyond every lie, beyond every temptation. This is the measuring rod for your Christianity. This is the measuring rod for my Christianity. I don't have to meet your measurements, and you don't have to meet mine. But I'll tell you what, I see what's in the Bible. That's my measuring rod. How much do we let the Holy Spirit guide us? How much do we hear from Jesus? How much do we honor him? How much do we let the Holy Spirit guide and direct our life? And how much do we tell the Holy Ghost what we want? I'm not talking about some super spiritual voice from heaven. I'm talking about simple direction. Hearing from Jesus. Honoring him. Being the church. Listening and moving as a pastor. Giving in all that you do. We're deemed by the Holy Ghost to succeed no matter how many times we fail, no matter how many ways in which we fail. We are deemed by the Holy Ghost no matter how many times we have failed or doomed to fail. We are deemed to success no matter how many times or ways we seem to succeed. It's all the Holy Ghost. Jude, verse 20. But you, beloved, building yourselves up on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Spirit, keep yourselves in the love of God, looking for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ unto eternal life. And on some, have compassion. On others, make a distinction. But with others, try to save them with fear, pulling them out of the fire, hating even the garment defiled by flesh. That's such a powerful verse of scripture. But you, beloved, build yourselves up by praying in the Holy Ghost. That's God's gym. I know Gold's gym, but I'm talking God's gym. I know there's 24-hour fitness. I know they're all shut down. God's gym is never shut down. questions never shut down. Want to build in unity? Holy Ghost. 1 Corinthians 14:3. He who speaks in the tongue edifies himself, but he who speaks the prophecies edifies the church. You need to build yourself up, edify yourself. It's okay to do that. Paul in verse 18 of the same chapter says, I thank my God that I speak with tongues more than you all. I think Paul might have come from himself. I'm only kidding. I speak in tongues more than you all. 1 Corinthians 14, verse 39 says, therefore, brethren, desire earnestly to prophesy, and do not forbid to speak in tongues. Let everything be done decently and in order. Settle the issue about what happens after Easter, and you'll settle every issue of life. Because the Holy Ghost settles all the issues of life. You know, 1 week from tomorrow, 13 years ago, on April the 16th of 2007, 32 young college students went to college like they did every day, and they were massacred in the second deadliest school shooting in history. It was 9:30 a.m. on October the 16th, 2007. Very few of them went that morning expecting to go to class and what would take place that day. Certainly, I would say that none of them expected to enter eternity that day. Christmas and Easter are about heaven and hell. They're about hearing from Jesus. They're about honoring him, and then what happens after Easter, and what happens after COVID-19. While those 32 people, the young college students at Virginia Tech, what was going on in their mind when they heard the gunshots go off and they started shouting? I wonder what was going through their mind when they were going to die. I can tell you this, they weren't thinking about their iPad. They weren't thinking about their instant message or their text messaging. They weren't thinking about their social media or their Instagram or their Facebook or their TikTok party. They weren't thinking about any of that. They weren't thinking about their grades. They weren't thinking about their car. They weren't thinking about the movies or the music or this guy or that girl. They were thinking probably at that time about God. And I'll bet a few of them were even trying to pray. I wonder how many did or how many even knew how. You know, forever is the most important issue of your life. It's far more important than what's going on right now. Only the Holy Ghost can convince you of that. But once you're convinced, and I'm convinced, nothing else is more important than hearing it from Jesus, than honoring Jesus, than heaven rather than hell. You can't help anyone that doesn't want to get it. But you can help everyone that does want to get it. Trust the Holy Ghost to take them the rest of the way. He's been taking me for 40 years. It's been a great ride. Are we listening to Jesus? Can you hear it from Jesus? What's going to happen after Easter for you this year? What's going to happen after COVID-19? That's the subject of another sermon. But I'll leave you with this one. I wonder if you bow your heads. Just close your eyes right there. We are. Every head is bowed, every eye is closed. There's no looking around. He shed his blood for you and I on the Calvary's cross. They buried him. He rose again on the third day. And by the power of his Holy Spirit, he's in your place right now. He's in your house. He's in your home. He's in your hospital room. He's right there where you are. How did he get there? By his Holy Spirit. And that's why he's coming to you. That's why he came to me. That's why he died on that cross that Easter Sunday. That Easter day. That's why he died on that cross. That's why he rose again on that third day. And that's what's happening after Easter is the church. that he's calling you to. That's the whole reason he did all he did. And that's the whole reason he does all he does. That we would hear him calling to us. Can you hear him tonight? You're here, and wherever you are, hear from Jesus. Honor him by simply allowing him to come into your heart tonight. Forgive you of your sins. You can't save yourself. Only he can. While heads are bowed and eyes are closed, and you're just honoring God, but just hearing from him. I want you to pray this prayer with me. It's not so much the words that you're going to be praying. It's the attitude of your heart. If there's any time in your life where you need to hear it from Jesus, you need to hear it now. And honor him. Because the issue really is heaven and hell. Say these words. Say, Father, in the name of Jesus, I come to you as I am, a sinner with no hope except the precious blood of Jesus Christ. Jesus, I believe that you died for me on that cross, Calvary. That they buried you and that you rose again on the third day. I want you to come into my heart by the power of your Holy Spirit. Begin to change my life from the inside out. Help me to forgive others who hurt me. Help me to forgive myself. Help me to forgive myself for hurting others. Father, I can't do that on my own. You can't forgive yourself. You've tried many times. Right now, tell them, right now, right where you are, open your mouth and speak out loud and say, I want you to be my Lord and to be my Savior. I'll turn from my sin and I'll follow you. In Jesus' name. If you prayed that prayer, I want you to get in touch with us. People know how to get in touch with people all over the place. Your Facebook, you know, messages. I don't know how you do all that stuff, but I'll find out if you respond on Facebook. We're at the corner of 147th and Crenshaw Boulevard. You can go on our website that I showed you. The big, just go South Bay. South Bay for Jesus will get you there. SBay4J.com will get you there. The door, SB.com will get you there. And all our information is on there, our phone numbers there. But I want to do one more thing. Maybe you haven't been born again and you've never spoken in tongues. It's not a matter of speaking in tongues. It's a matter of you letting the Holy Spirit have you. Very clear. Read the gospel, the fifth gospel. It's the whole reason Jesus came. And right there where you are, you can be filled with the Holy Spirit with the evidence of speaking in other tongues. We're going to pray a simple prayer, and then at the end of that, I just want you to open your mouth and open it and let your tongue and your lips go any way they want to go. Don't try to speak in English or Spanish or any other language. Let him fill you with another language, a prayer language. And he'll do that right there where you are. I want you to say, Father, in the name of Jesus, right now, I thank you that I've been born again. I thank you that your Holy Spirit dwells in me. Father, I want to surrender all of my life. I want the Holy to be filled with the Holy Spirit. Right now, I want to just surrender my tongue and my lips to you and help me to speak in the heavenly language that your Spirit moving through my life and speaking unto you. And right now, just begin. Open your mouth and begin to utter whatever comes out. Don't look for words.
Father God, we thank you, Lord God. We praise you, Lord God. We give you all the glory, Lord God. Hallelujah.
This is an amazing God. The reason he came, Christmas and Easter,
It's all about heaven and hell. It's hearing from him, it's honoring him, and it's heaven rather than hell. Hope that you'll tune in on Sunday morning at 10:30 and Sunday evening at 6:30. Go to the Tucson website, thedoorchurch.live. Maybe something like that. If you just go thedoorchurch, door.church/live will come up. And register to be part of that 40-day fast. You don't have to fast for 40 days. I was doing that. But see what's going to happen. Put your prayer request in. Even if you're not going to fast, put your prayer request in. We're going to sing a song, Lift Jesus Higher, and then we'll count ourselves finished.
Lift Jesus higher, lift Jesus higher, lift him up for the world to see. He said, if I be lifted up from the earth, I will draw all men unto me. Lift Jesus higher, lift Jesus higher, lift him up for the world to see. Said, if I be lifted up from the earth, I will draw all men unto me.